Hello, I am Mr. Satish Thalange, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Walchand Technology, Solapur. In today's session, we are going to see the critical path method for project management. At the end of the session, the students is going to compare the critical path method network with the Gantt chart for the project management. Now let's see what is a critical path method. In short, it is also called as CPM. Critical path method is a graphical and the logical presentation of the project and its activities. It was developed by the worker and Kili. It is used for the repeated type of projects and it is an activity-oriented network technique. It is a deterministic approach type of technique because as it is used for the repeated type of projects, here the particularly deterministic times are being derived. Yeah, this is a particularly AOA type of network technique. In this particular, CPM is represented by activity on arrow type. The critical activities and the critical activity path are been derived with the particularly activity times. Here, the critical path is the longest path in the particular network diagram, which is going to help us to derive the project duration, or you can say overall project duration of the network. Here, if there are more than one critical path, then the longest path is used to define the critical path and it is used to define the project duration. Now, let me start with the event time. In this particular diagram, we are observing the yellow color box, which are representing the event times. The above and the below are both the event times of first. Here, it is the earliest event time, which is represented with the capital T at the foot E. When we observe this yellow bracket, we see that capital EE1 means what? It is the earliest event time of event 1. And similarly for the event 2, 3 and 4, we are representing capital TE2, capital TE3 and capital TE4. And here in the below yellow color box, here we are representing the capital TL1, which is the latest event time. It is a backward moving time calculation, and the earliest event time is a forward moving time calculation. Forward moving means what? From left hand side to right hand side. Here we will move from particular right hand here from this left hand side to the right hand side for the earliest event time, and from the right hand side to the left hand side for the latest event time calculations. Here the particular TL1 is the latest time of event 1 and TL2 is the latest time of particular event 2. These are the durations, that is small t 1 2. This 1 2 are nothing else. It is representing this is a time between event 1 2 and t 2 3 is nothing else. It is a duration of activity B event between event 2 and 3. So to calculate the particular event, earlier event and the latest event times, as we have said, forward movement and backward movement. Here we have to say that a TE1 is equal to 0 because it is starting, and here TE2 is 3 because 0 plus 3 is equal to 3. Similarly, we have to see for the forward events, that is 3 plus 2, that is 5, 5 plus 3 is 8. And we have to carry same time of the particular earliest event time to the latest event time 8. 8 minus 3 is equal to 5. Now let's see the activity time. The activity times are four types: earliest start time, earliest finish time, latest start time and latest finish time. Here earliest start time is a time of the activity which should start as early as possible, and earliest finish time is a time of the activity, means activity should finish as early as it should finish. Here particularly activity A, B and C, here its earliest time is 0 because as it is a starting activity and its tail event is 1, its earliest event time is 0. That 0 is equal to, we have to, that's why the earliest starting time is 0. This 0 plus 3 is equal to 3. That is the earliest finishing time. And similarly, this particular time is the earliest event time of event 2. So I will write here 3. 3 will is a, as it is a tail event of activity B, it will be earliest starting time of activity B. Now 3 is a, we have to mention here, 3 plus 2, 5. Similarly, we have to carry forward the activity C. Now the backward path, we have to see, as we have obtained the earliest starting time and the earliest finish time for all the activities from moving from the left hand side to the right hand side, we have to derive the latest start time and latest finish time of the each activity moving from right hand side to the left hand side. Here, once we get the latest event time of event 4, that is 8, we have to mention it's here, the latest finish time is equal to particularly latest event time, that is 8. 8 minus 3, it is 5. Here, the latest starting time of activity C is 5. Now, this is equal to particularly latest event time of particular 3, this 5, which is again equal to latest finishing time of activity B. This 5 minus 2, it is again 3. Similarly, we have to move from right hand side to the left hand side. We will get the particularly latest start time as a finish time. This is a overall time calculations of particularly event as well as the activity. Now, this is a forward path. This is a forward path and backward path. How to define the forward path? As I earlier told, that forward path is nothing else. It is moving from left hand side to the right hand side of the network. Here in this particular diagram, the particularly forward paths are represented by the black color arrows above this particular red arrows. This particular arrows are moving from left hand side to the right hand side. And backward path is a path which is obtained or which is used to derive the latest time moving from the right hand side to the left hand side. In this particular network diagram, the backward path is represented by the red color arrows. When we are going to construct the network diagram, as we move from the forward path direction, the maximum times are taken for the next forward activity here, and during the backward path, the minimum times are taken for the latest times. Later we will see in the particular example. Here, the float of the activity. The float of activity is nothing else. It is a flexible range of a time of a particular activity in the project by which that particular activity can be delayed without affecting the overall project duration. Here, the float is obtained by the difference between the latest start time and latest, or you can say earliest start time, or you can say latest finish time and earliest finish time of the particular activity. Here there is a calculation of the particular floats of the each activities. The particular float LST minus EST, when we take the example of A, the LST is 0 and the EST is 0. 0 minus 0, we are getting 0. Means what? This particularly activity is having the 0 float, which is mean as critical activity. When we see that activity B, here the LST minus EST, here the particular B activity LST is 5 and particularly EST is 3. 5 minus 3, we are getting 2. Here the particular float is more than 0, so it is this particular activity B is non-critical activity. Means what? In short, the float, if it is equal to 0, that particular activity is critical one. If float is more than 0, that particular activity is non-critical activity. Here the critical activities are represented by the arrows, and the particular critical path is defined by the event as well as activity. Today's question, this is a question. Here we are going to construct the network diagram and the Gantt chart for the following project. This is a network diagram of our question. In this network diagram, when we have calculated all the event times and the activity times, we are getting the activities as two critical activities and two non-critical activities. Here, when we go for the construction of the Gantt chart of the particular problem, this is a Gantt chart construction of a particular problem. When we start to compare between this particular network diagram and the Gantt chart, here in the Gantt chart, we won't see any critical path or you can say critical activity representation. But in the network diagram, when we go for the construction, when we see the floats of particular activities, we come to know activity B and D are the critical one, which needs a more or can say a more overview and continuous monitoring for that particular activity to start and the complete. And the activity A and B, A and C are the non-critical activity. But this particular representation is not been there in the Gantt chart. And here in the network diagram, we see the interdependency of the particular activities can be shown easily. But in the bar chart, it is the major drawback is that here the interdependency is representation is not there. This is a drawback of between you can say drawback of the Gantt chart when compared with the network diagram. This is a reference for today's session. Thank you.